So thanks for coming back. So I probably don't need to make the same blurb again then about why I'm interested in this area. But yeah, probably just to briefly say I'm Emma Meehan and I'm a researcher at the Centre for Dance Research. And I've had these conversations with the Disruptive Media Learning Lab about am I interested in somatic movement approaches, which we'll hear more about later, and how these can interact with technology and maybe thinking about how this can be used with different client groups, including with third level students. So somatic practices, you may know from last week, work a lot with the body and mind working together, developing self-reflection and awareness so that maybe you can challenge habits and open up your capacity for movement. And a lot of somatic practitioners like to work away from technology. There's a growing number of somatic practitioners who actually work really closely with technology, and Tamara is one of them. And she edited an issue of the Journal of Dance and Somatic Practices, which is here if you'd like to take a look, and wrote an article about this. So we've invited her to talk today because last week Lisa talked about an app that was actually in process, and Tamara is going to talk about one which she actually has already developed. So that'll be really interesting to hear about what formats she used. So I think I'll leave it at that. We were going to do a small experience of somatic practices. We did it last time at the start, and I thought it was a nice way into the talk. And before that, I just will say, you know, Tamara is here with us today, and she's a senior lecturer at University of Bedfordshire. And you'll talk about this iPad app that you developed. Is there anything else I should mention about your background or? Okay, yeah. Perfect.
I'm going to do a combination of talking and reading. I'm going to read some of the article that I wrote, and because some of the discourse gets a bit complicated when it gets into analysing the literature, I will read those bits. But then I'm also going to talk about what we did in the project as well. So this project was an app design project that took place between 2013 and 2016. So it was a 3-year project, and it was a partnership between MovieStorm, who are a software development company based in Cambridge, Dance Digital, who were an arts organisation focusing on digital technology, and I was the artistic director at the time, and the University of Bedfordshire. And it was a very in-depth project, so we spent a lot of time on the development of ideas. We were lucky that we had funding from the Digital R&D Research Fund, from NESTA, the AHRC and Arts Council. And that really afforded us, I think, a research process that perhaps you might not normally have time for. It allowed us to work in depth with special needs schools and really bring them into the process of app design. And that was really special. That was really interesting for us because we could really observe the young people, talk to the young people, and really bring their viewpoints into the design process. And for us, that was amazing and very special. And that also enabled me as the researcher to start to really perceive and analyse the somatic potential in what we were doing. And that ended up becoming quite an important discourse in the project. So just a project overview. So the project was called Form Extended, and it was the idea that you're extending the form of the body, and also just making some reference to Cunningham and the life forms technology that was obviously developed a lot earlier. And also the organisation was looking at the representation of bodies in gaming, in particular, and it became very apparent that there weren't very many inclusions of disabled avatars. And this did start off as an avatar-based project. So we had an idea that you would follow avatars on the screen. And we had initially, there was an idea that we would put in different avatars with different dimensions, with different disabilities. So you would have different role models to kind of follow and play with and make choreography with. The Form Extended project was specifically aimed at young people in special needs schools. So we were really working with young people with a range of disabilities, sensory and motor impairment, and they were all coming at it from those different experiences. But we did try and design it with everyone in mind, and actually in the process we did do some testing sessions with HE students, university students as well. So it was quite interesting in the final stages of the project to see that the app could be used in multiple settings. But the app really explores how young people can be introduced to dance in a non-competitive way and not in the kind of PE context way, because obviously you're working in the school setting, so we're looking at creative dance practice. So we initially started looking at a cross-platform application aimed at young people aged 7 to 12. And we wanted them to be able to choreograph their own simple dance pieces and then therefore provide an entry for dance as an art form. So you could, the idea was that you could pick up the app, you didn't necessarily have to have any dance experience, and it would give you some moving experience, some choreography experience, and it would hopefully spark an interest in your dance, in dance for you. The project tested whether the platform could provide this kind of entry point for children, especially those with disabilities, and it was focusing on a tool for creative engagement. And the project's aims were to strengthen movement-based learning activity in schools through the digital environment, offer an inclusive entry point to engage the broadest young user group possible, offer an online platform for teachers who want to embed movement in their teaching but do not feel confident in moving themselves. And actually the project involved us collaborating with many teachers and teaching assistants and talking about the kind of activities that they would feel comfortable doing and the kind of digital environment that would facilitate that as well. And some of the findings of the project were also to do with the pedagogy and the learning environment of the classroom, which we can talk about later. We haven't actually written that up so much in the research findings. So there were the partners who came together, and with these partners who came together, we sought to employ collaborative research methods where all members of the team, be they an artist, be they a researcher, be they a software designer, could input creatively. So at the start of the project, for example, we did a 3-month lab phase where the software artist, the dance artist, the researcher, all of us were sharing a dance studio together and doing tasks together. And that ended up being really important in terms of app design because we had had the software artists moving with us from the very beginning. And that gave them a really different insight. And so when they went into schools, they had more empathy for what the moving experience was like, what the experience was like working with young people as well. And then obviously when we came to making the app itself and the outputs of the project, we all fulfilled our roles as artists, technologists, educators and researchers. So I became responsible for writing things up and trying to make sense of some of the findings that we have. So these were the research questions in the main project. They're quite broad research questions, and they refer to the avatar, and I'll talk about that, how we moved away from that idea in the project. But in what ways do interactive technologies enhance understanding of inclusive choreographic practice, with reference to interface design and avatars for young disabled users? I have to emphasise that this was really a pilot and a testing project, and that's, we got the funding to do the testing and the piloting of the kind of the design issues that were coming up in working with these specific populations. How do users who have physical disabilities experience and understand choreographic practice? In what ways can animated avatars serve as effective tools for the development of choreography and creative practice in dance? And how can the design of avatars and interactive interfaces come to embody values of inclusion and diversity as they engage the users? So really, these are the research questions that we put on our funding application. And as we got into the research, they very quickly shifted. So I'll just show you who the team was. So you can see it's quite a large team, a mix of artists, dance artists, software artists. We had a dance artist and disability arts specialist, Susie Birchwood, who directs At One Arts Base in Hertfordshire, and is very, very experienced. And she was great because she brought the experience of a disabled dance artist into the project, but she also is a very experienced teacher as well. So when we were in the school context, she was very helpful in terms of thinking through tasks and working with the young people. And all of us, I'm thinking back now about what we actually did, but all of us went into the school. So, you know, there are quite often 7-8 of us in the school setting with the young people, watching, observing, participating, teaching, writing. And I'm now thinking back, thinking actually that's quite radical in some ways to have that many people in a classroom. But the schools were completely up for it, and we'd done a lot of conversations with them to kind of set all this up. So, just moving on. So, the research design, we had a first phase was a creative lab between all of the partners, as I said, and that was really what we did in that lab was we were sharing knowledge, so we were exploring existing apps for choreography and dance. We were exploring teaching methods for young people. We were exploring some of the work of Movie Storm. They had already made these interactive avatars where there's one avatar they have where you could move a horse and ride a horse and send a horse on a journey, and we were kind of playing with that. It was basically just getting to know each other and building kind of a very strong collaborative relationship between all of us. The second phase, we were testing our ideas in school, so we didn't have any app developed yet. We were testing activities that we thought we would put into the app, and we were testing some of the apps that were already out there, like Polyfauna and Soima, which I'll talk about later. And then we were asking the young people for feedback. So we'd go in, do an hour session, and then we would have a focus group with the young people and ask them for their feedback on experiences, what they enjoyed. And also I was observing, like, where were they paying attention? Where was their attention getting lost and all those kinds of things, which in kind of engaging young people and in movement practice, it's quite important, like, when do they lose attention? And I think when we're in the app environment or in the interactive technology environment, our attention can get shifted very quickly, and we take our attention away from activities very quickly. And I think in the contemporary culture as well, we're kind of pulled in lots of directions. So we were quite interested in how does an activity sustain? How do people stay engaged? How do they not get bored? Because quite often also in programming, obviously in programming, you can have an open-ended environment, but then there are limited pathways. You get to know the game, and then you know the game. You know all the patterns in the game. And so then how do you keep people engaged? And that was a question for us in terms of design and in terms of teaching as well. And in terms of money, because if you want to make something very open-ended, creative, non-linear, and abstract in software, it uses more data. So, and then that has cost implications. So all of that was discussed. And then after the phase of working in schools, we then went into the app design phase. And that was very intensive working between the team, and we weren't really working with schools at that point. And going backwards and forwards, looking at the app environments, looking at the visual, looking at the visual design, trying out the activities ourselves, rendering, re-rendering, the software team getting feedback, and just trying to really develop. We settled on 4 environments in the end, which I'll show to you. But that was kind of the gritty part of, you know, the doing of it, really. And then once we had an app prototype, we took it into schools. And we did some testing and some observations of how the young people responded to it. And we have findings from that which would go into a finalisation of the product, which we still haven't finalised. So that's where the project kind of got to is. So investigating inclusive approaches to interface design. So Kim von Codden, who was working for Dance Digital as the executive producer on the project, was very concerned with the underrepresentation of disabled bodies in gaming and online worlds. And she identified this mismatch between the large number of people in the real world who live with disabilities and those online. And in the mismatch was the potential for the development of this app. So this is what we were trying to explore. And that was a key research question for the team. How was the app inclusive in its design? And I think there are still questions about that, and I don't know that we have fully resolved it. I think there's always questions to be asked around that. And yet engaging to a wide range of populations. The team was committed to developing a product that wasn't an assistive assistive technology targeted at a particular group. So it wasn't trying to remedy a perceived deficit or a perceived lack of something. It wasn't assistive. We were trying to do something that was creative, that could be accessed by those with and without physical disabilities. The team was interested in finding out what constituted an inclusive environment for software where disabled users could engage with activities without specific adaptations made in the app design. So in phase one of the research, we looked at other creative dance tools, which I've got here, some pictures of some of them. So we looked at the Simpson board, which although isn't an app, I think it should be. and the Simpson board is something that was developed by Adam Benjamin about 20 years ago. You may have come across it. And it's got symbols on the board which are drawn from notation. And the idea is that an artist can sit with the board on their chair in front of them, and they can point to symbols, and they can ask dancers to move in particular ways, and they can choreograph using the board. And I have been in a project with this, and it is very effective, but it puts the choreographer in the position of directing another dancer to realise their ideas. But yeah, I'm surprised that hasn't been made into an app yet, to be quite honest, because it's so, the way it's laid out and the way it works is so, I don't know, it's app-like in its thinking, I think. So Adam Benjamin was kind of ahead of the game there. We looked at Moving Space, which is an app developed by Brenton Chang. And that takes the space harmony work from the Laban system into the app environment. And it maps things like the A scale, the B scale, the rings. If you don't know Laban, there are all these spatial pathways that can be mapped. And they map them in a cube. They map them in an icosahedron, so these three-dimensional shapes. And they map them in an octahedron, which is there. And you can follow the pathways with your body. So you can make all these really lovely three-dimensional patterns. But again, you're interfacing with the app, kind of holding it and following it like this. And then we looked at Soima and Polyfauna, which are more three-dimensional. So, talk about Polyfauna. In Polyfauna, you're following, this is an app developed by Radiohead, maybe people have played on it, you're following this red dot. And this was actually something that all of us on the team really related to, is because it took us out of our up, down, side, side. It took us into circular motion, it took us down and up, it took us in, like, almost the experience of going into the screen. And in terms of movement, that was kind of very interesting to us because we'd also been playing on the Kinect where you can kind of follow an avatar and just, but it ends up being very two-dimensional. And so this app design was the first one that we experienced in the research process that took us into this, what we understand as three-dimensional movement, took us out of our habits, took us out of what, you know, you can plan where you're going, took us into kind of unexpected movement. So that was really interesting to us, and that actually became something that we really wanted to incorporate into the design. So a key finding from this phase of the research was that the team wanted the app itself to generate movement by users in space that involved more than the hands also. Observations on the Polyfauna app revealed that the red dot caused the user to move the tablet through their full range of motion and locomote through the space, whether on foot or in a wheelchair. So they might have been holding it in the chair and their assistant was moving them around, or the assistant would be holding the tablet and then they would be following it around. But it really took them out of forward, back, side, side. We had this going on in the chair, which was really lovely to watch. Also with these, with this app in particular, the students could work in groups to create overlapping formations that resulted from their individual following of the red dot on their iPads. One student could lead another student with a creative echoing duet. An interface that involved three-dimensional navigation of an environment was revealed to be an engaging and viable stimulus for the development of interesting movement and choreographic material. In this particular activity, it was noted how users in and out of wheelchairs actively participated in their own ways for sustained periods of time. So a small tripod was also mounted on the wheelchair, which offered potential for following as well. So we were really trying to think about how to make things accessible. And if dexterity in the hands prevented participants from holding the iPad, the assistant would do that. So going and looking into some of the connections between somatics and computing. As the researcher in the project, it was my role to document and analyse the learning, the creative and choreographic knowledges that were generated by users of the app, and to facilitate reflective dialogues through the development phase, to ask lots of questions and kind of analyse what was happening in the group. Approaching the research from a somatic perspective, I was concerned with how first-person bodily experiences could inform the research process and perhaps inform the app design. So I was asking, how did you feel after an activity? How does your body feel? What happened for you? Did you notice any changes? Martha Eddy writes that the goal of the somatic movement professional is to heighten both sensory and motor awareness to facilitate a student client's own self-organisation, self-healing or self-knowing. Open-ended, unfolding approaches that value self-discovery are common in somatic practices, as we experienced this morning. As a researcher, I was curious about how the app might stimulate heightened sensory and motor awareness, as well as looking for opportunities for the development of self-knowledge, confidence, and autonomy through the use of the app in movement. As such, throughout the process, I pursued an investigation of how app design could embody somatic principles, where app-based activities might promote the development of the kinds of self-knowledge described above by Eddie. Additionally, Levishan and Shiphorst proposed somatics as a useful research in computer interface design, where, quote, the techniques utilised in the field of somatics function as unique and valuable research methods, providing a way to gather empirical data that are of a first-person nature. When gathering these first-person perspectives, I was interested in how they might evidence the development of self-learning and self-knowledge emerging from the use of the app in the testing phases. Such information could allow the team to refine the app design and optimise activities for the development of self-learning through engaging sensory-motor bodily systems. An aim of the research was to test the accessibility of activities by accessing engagement with features of the iPad, mostly through the hands, by activating the touchscreen, accelerometer and dimension sensors. As such, I took some specific observations and research on the use of the hands in mobile technologies. Moreover, there was a concern with how to engage the hands in creative ways, which I'm going to talk about now. Most encounters with somatic practices take place through human-to-human interaction. The use of touch, imagery, guided exploration and partnering often form part of the learning process. In the Form Extended project, I wanted to investigate if and how the app itself could offer a learning environment informed by somatic principles to create the conditions for somatic learning. Like, can you pick up the app and have a somatic dialogue with it? Can it give you the kind of information that your little exercise gave us earlier just by interacting with the app itself? Could conditions for self-learning and self-organisation be created so that movement learning could be individually unique, bespoke and idiosyncratic to each student? I think that's key in somatic practice, that we quite often talk about everybody's experience in somatics being unique and different and individual. So even if we're all doing the same exercise, the outcome for each person will be entirely different because we are all different. And so we're not looking for a uniform outcome in the response to the task and the exercise. In order to look at how somatic principles might be integrated into the software design, I identified some shared principles between somatic practices and computing. Identifying these shared principles was a key part of the research process because it enabled the team to align and integrate movement practice, computer interaction and coding-based activities for testing in schools. The identification of these shared principles also led the team to consider a range of interactive activities for testing that included avatar-based experiences and more abstract non-narrative based experiences, which are described below. There's been relatively little research on the role of somatic practice in software design, but there are some intersections in philosophy of education that used to be align somatic practice and commuting in the curricular context. Blickstein identifies educational theorists Dewey, Frere and Papert as the theoretical pillars for the design of digital and computing education, because each one of these theorists advocates for a curriculum emerging from the interests of students. So again, it's this self-generated inquiry that's happening in their pedagogies. For example, Papert asserts that technology can serve as an emancipatory tool by putting the most powerful technological materials in the hands of children. Allowing students to play, to create systems from hardware, software, and the moving body gives them agency and purpose in the development of meaningful outputs supported by artistic, scientific, and technological thinking. Dewey and Freire emphasize the importance of dialogue in learning, and Freire offers the model of developing generative themes with students. Where the end goal of an activity is not predefined, such approaches to supporting and structuring learning are helpful in that they enable knowledge gained by students to be recognised and valued. This responsive approach to students' inquiries might be supported by exploring the pedagogies of Freire, Dewey and Papert in integration with dance and somatic practices. The skill of creating scores in improvisation, for example, has much to offer the development of collaborative learning systems unique to the student, school and educational setting. Further exploring the work of Dewey reveals well-developed connections between his educational philosophies and body-mind practices, which in the contemporary context might be categorised as somatic. So Dewey was a long-term student of Alexander, and his study of Alexander technique influenced his broader philosophy of education. So Dewey's philosophy of education is very much about process, that learning is unfolding, we're learning together, that the school is a microcosm of society. And a lot of that is informed by his experience working with Alexander. Writing in 1928, Dewey asserts that the full realisation of the integration of the mind and body in action waits upon the reunion of philosophy and science in the supreme art of education. Dewey proposed that education could be integrative in its approach to disciplines and reminded his readers of the term techne, which used in ancient Greece to describe both arts and science. He says, in Greece, there was a time when philosophy, science and the arts and medicine were much closer together than they have been since. One word described both art and science, techne. Now, at the time of writing this research, we're also going through the STEM, STEAM, arts debate in the curriculum and the marginalisation of the arts in the curriculum. And so while we were talking with schools, while we were developing the app, we were very interested in this idea of STEAM. So the integration of science, technology, engineering, the arts and mathematics rather than STEM, which takes out the arts. So a full investigation of the connections between Alexander and Dewey could be the topic of some more research. The recognition of techne as a form of knowledge and knowledge in action that enacts the disciplines in integration is helpful. According to Martinez and Stasia, the maker community also brings people together across disciplines, and they assert that the discipline divisions between the arts and sciences are not helpful in the real world. For example, algorithmic and mathematical thinking supports clarity of coding and software design, while a keen visual and spatial intelligence supports the scenographic design of projections, and well-developed bodily and kinesthetic understanding enables the generation of interesting choreographic material. The creative explorations possible in dance and technology enable students to move between these different modes of knowing in a problem-solving process. For example, here follows a description of one of the creative explorations undertaken by the team. A student engages visually with a projection, triggering a proximity sensor that reveals their body in a colour. The student is asked to work with other students to change the colours on the screens together. The students perceive themselves and the group, organised spatially and kinesthetically, and slowly an ensemble composition of movement emerges. As the students improvise with the projection, they realise that their formations change the range of colours and play with proximity, and a play with proximity and colour design ensues. In such a context, students can develop a range of artistic, mathematical design, computing and scientific thinking skills as they engage in the process of making a digital performance piece. Thinking laterally across the disciplines, improvising with possibilities, play, solution finding and collaboration are the features of such learning environments. Cybernetic artist and philosopher Roy Ascott offers insight into this way of working that locates bodies, materials, practices and elements on a level playing field, where the concern of the participant becomes about enacting flows of matter and energy rather than concerns of concretising and representing oneself in a stable form, which also takes us back to Dewey, this idea that we're always in process, that learning is a process, and that working with technology really brings us into that as a reality, because you're always in interaction and it's always developing and it's always accumulating. So what is at stake here is the construction of a fluid reality, not a fixing of forms and representation. Art practice in this way of viewing the world becomes a topological activity in which flows of energy and matter are discovered in terms of their processes of becoming in the world. Ascot's concern is to generate what he calls a moist practice in which silicons and pixels merge with molecules and matter. That was written about 15 years ago. I have other thoughts on that now. And where the moist environment located at the convergence of the digital, biological and spiritual is essentially a dynamic environment involving artificial and human intelligence in non-linear processes of emergence, construction and transformation. In short, Ascot recognises that the flows of information and energy occur between the biological and the technical, and this is about our interactive environment. A key idea for this research is that somatic principles of self-organisation and the development of self-knowledge situate in an open-ended fluid system that can incorporate engagement with all kinds of tools, be they touch, images, or guided activities in the app environment. In terms of software design, a concern is how to create environments with sufficient complexity to facilitate in the user's thinking and movement patterns. Taking such research into account, the analysis of observational data was one of the ways in which the team attempted to achieve an app design of appropriate complexity in both concepts and tasks. In mobile technologies, the hand and the screen have become coupled through an increasingly complex configuration of gestures that affect actions on the screen and extend into the virtual world. Recent research draws attention to the integration or entanglement of gestural, physical, cognitive, psychological and technological processes in the use of touchscreen technologies. Cranny Francis points out that touchscreens naturalise experiences for their users so that the user is encouraged to forget the interface and act as if the experience is directly embodied, with the technology effectively incorporated into the experience and understanding of the human. And if you're thinking about cognition as a process and the body as part of that process and your actions as part of that process, it's easy to see how these boundaries can be dissolved. In agreement with the views of Ascot, as outlined above, in touchscreen technologies, she argues that the seam between human and technology might well be blurred. Moreover, research has further demonstrated that mobile touchscreens are an aspect of our embodiment, objects of tactile and kinesthetic familiarity. Further to that, there are discussions on how on-screen representations accessed through gestures become condensed in the hand, and that bodily movement comes to correlate with on-screen action. I don't know if anyone's ever studied Feldenkrais, but in Feldenkrais there's an idea that if you do something in one part of the body, it actually can affect, changes the whole. And so this is a similar idea in our use of the hands with the touchscreen environment. In developing the software, the team was keen to recognise and acknowledge potential implications for embodiment, cognition and habit forming in the physical engagement with the app. Frank Wilson further elaborates on how the hands synthesise various embodied processes in their use. So he says, when we connect the hands to real life, in other words, we confront the open-ended and overlapping worlds of the sensory, motor and cognitive function and the endless combinations of speed, strength, dexterity seen in individual human skill and performance. And you might just explore your own hand while you're listening. It's quite a nice thing to do. Gestures made might be thought of a micro choreography or small dance with the fingers, but the repetition of movements through functional use might also build up patterns of use. Observations did reveal some preferences in interface engagement, whether through the use of the hands or the whole body. So these are some of the observations that we had on app engagement. And we were looking for sustainment. So we were looking for when people were deeply involved in an activity. So it's observed that the young people engaged for sustained periods when they were creating layered images of themselves in the group through proximity sensors. So we actually had an app environment projected on the wall and they could build these kind of three-dimensional sculptures by moving around the space. Creating images using finger swipes on the touch screen, so it's drawing. Navigating an abstract world such as space and planets by moving the screen through space. This kind of activity generated lots of creative responses that could be developed into duets and group movement works with and without the iPads. These three key observations underpin the app design and the balance between functional, creative and open-ended use of the hands in engaging with the touch interface informed the design of the app in so much as there was a commitment to creating an environment that enabled non-linear swipes to create movement trails or patterns. A navigation game that made use of the accelerometer was also included in the design, and this enabled users to move through worlds of the game by tipping, rotating and flipping the screen. Functional uses were necessarily included for key actions such as returning to the home screen and progressing through the different environments. Voice recognition was also planned into the design for users with limitations to dexterity, but we haven't got that far. Each of the app activities was also designed to elicit different forms of movement response. Observations revealed that student engagement with avatars, while initially stimulating and fun, were not as in-depth or sustained as students' engagement with more abstract virtual worlds, and this is where we kind of discarded the idea of the avatar. In their engagement with abstract environments, the children evidenced greater range in spatial exploration, development of richer narratives, more creative storytelling, and more interaction with one another in exchange of their ideas developed through the non-linear abstract app-based tasks. Additionally, guidance and intervention from the teaching artists in the session was less when the app-based activities involved the navigation of abstract environments. And so it was inferred that apps with abstract environments also better supported the development of student autonomy and self-learning. This finding was a key turning point in the research and development of the app. Initially, we had planned an avatar. I've said all this. Development of an abstract environment invited a thorough reflection on the technological aspect of the process, because actually MovieStorm had started to develop an avatar, and we kind of got to the end of the testing phase in school and we're like, no, no, we don't want the avatar. And so they had to, yeah, all of this cost money. So they had to go back and rethink. They were with us, but as an organisation, it did affect them, because it's, when you're doing things like this, it's quite intense and it takes a lot of resource. The use of open frameworks for coding abstract environments was discussed, and the initial plans for the development of the app were revised. Interestingly, when the students were surveyed on their preferences, they were more or less evenly split. So that we actually did ask them, do you prefer the avatar or do you prefer the non-linear abstract environment? And the initial dialogue, they were kind of evenly split. They were like, oh, I like them evenly. But additional dialogue also revealed that the abstract environments tended to encourage more physical and active response. So as well as saying, did you enjoy it? What did you like? We also said, well, in which environment did you experience more physicality? Where did you find that you were moving more? And that's where we got the answers about the abstract environment. When asked what they enjoyed about the robot animation, the avatar, one student responded, said that it was funny and it made me laugh. And another student responded, it had a story, the robot story was good. When asked what was enjoyable about the abstract app, where students were following the dot in space, one student responded that you have to move all the time. And another student responded that they liked moving through the landscape. So it was observed that these abstract environments, as I've said, really encouraged the engagement of the whole body. And so we were interested in developing an app that really stimulates movement and really gets people moving in new ways as well. And so that's how we developed the planet navigation activity, which became the entry activity to the app. In discussion, the research and development team was of the view that abstract environments with no allusion to the human form would also promote inclusive practice, in that there would be no external body to refer to. So you're not looking at another body and comparing yourself to that. There is no body there in the environment at all. In initial discussions with MovieStorm, the proposal was that the app included the avatars and that we would enter people's body data into the app so that the avatar almost looked like you. However, I think the full potentials of that were revealed to be limited. So we structured and supported an unfolding creative environment in the app. Research in movement education and somatic practice supports the views that were arrived at by the team and actually reinforced the design decisions taken in the process of refining the app. So in this app design development phase, I took some of the literature to the meetings and said, you know, like when we're looking at really how to develop people's creativity, how to engage people in new ways with their bodies, some of the somatic practice literature is saying, you know, this, you know, open-ended and self-learning, self-generating. So that was helpful. So the movement responses to the abstract world represented three-dimensionally in the screen elicited movement responses that included the full revolutions of the body, deep twists to follow the objects in the space, lots of changes of level and locomotion through the space. The three-dimensional space in the screen became embodied and actualized in the movement responses of the users, and from there they could make their own choreographies or their own movement patterns that they put together. From a developmental movement perspective, spirals and three-dimensional movement offer potential for healthy alignment in embodied movement patterns. For example, Peggy Hackney asserts that moving with a constant changing relationship to three spatial pulls is in harmony with the topographical alignment of the muscles from origin to insertion with the structural characteristics of the individual muscles. So if you look at your muscles, they actually do pattern in a spiral. If you actually look inside the body, the muscles are generally wrapping around. And actually, if you look at the bones as well, there are very small spirals. So we're made of spirals, which I think is really nice. Being able to create activities that invited such movement responses became of interest to the team because such activities not only seemed to offer more creative, open-ended, and inclusive ways of moving, but also supported the developmental movement health of the users. The impact of longer-term engagements with app activities on the development of movement and thinking patterns in user populations might inform future research projects. I've got a summary of the app. So this is a summary of the four environments in the app. So the entry point, obviously it's not animated, but it's just screenshots. The entry point was this world's navigation, and you would kind of tip the screen and guide yourself to a world, and then you would go into one of these three environments. The sound sculpture would build, so the iPad would make a sound, you'd tip it, and it would build a visual image, but also it would make tones and sounds. And if you change the speed of it, it would also change the pitch and the speed of the sound. And we had a function in there where you could record it as well. So you could compose your own sound score for choreography, which was really fun. Really lots of fun. This interactive silhouette, it would capture the outline of the body. You can see someone's head in there. And then you could have multiple bodies in there, and you could play with proximity. This one we actually used in workshops, and we not only had it on the iPads, but we projected it on the wall as well, and we used the Kinect with it, so you could have a big version of it. And actually in our workshops, I was talking to Emma about this earlier, we had a lot of this zooming between the micro environment on the iPad itself, and then the macro environment using projectors and making a more immersive environment in the classroom. And that was lots of fun because when you're in a classroom, you've obviously got the potential for lots of group work. And it's lots of fun playing games and doing ensemble compositions with things like this. And the colours change as you move close or go far away. And yeah, the kids get very excited. And you see if you can get gradations of colour by the way you make spatial formations. And it's lots of fun, especially if you're teaching like very basic principles of choreography. It's really, really helpful. And then the painting app was one that really you use, I think, in the app itself. Didn't work so well projected, but you could reveal parts, if it had a camera, and you could reveal yourself by kind of doing etch-a-sketch. So it was a little bit like an etch-a-sketch, and you could draw patterns into it. So this was the prototype of the app, and we had lots of ideas for activities, and I guess these were the ones that had the most potential and crystallised the easiest across the team. So key design decisions. That we wanted a handheld device to give a three-dimensional engagement, that you're not here, that it really takes you somewhere and off your vertical axis. We wanted multi-sensory interaction, so we did want the voice activation, but we hadn't been able to put it in yet, but also that it makes sound when you move it, and that you have a range of ways of stimulating activity. So moving the iPad would create a sound composition, using your hands would create a visual composition, moving close and away to it would create another kind of visual composition. We wanted to build into it the possibility for collaboration with other users, which I think that really needs a teaching assistant or a teacher with the group at the moment in the way that it's designed. We wanted a highly visual design emphasising animation. You know, you do something and you see the effect. Yeah, and that's really important with young people, that they can really relate to what's happening on the screen. We wanted this sustained engagement, that you didn't after 5 minutes get bored and just put it down. And I think that is a design question for all developers, really, how you really create that sustained engagement. And I don't know that we completely solved it. I don't know. I'd have to play with the app a lot longer, I think. And that also is whether it's kind of a valid learning tool in the classroom or not. You know, if it works in one workshop, great, but if you're going to invest all that money in iPads and in the app, you want it to at least give you a term's worth of curriculum, I would say, you know, or 6 weeks. And the ability to use the app to enhance live performance and choreography by using it as a compositional tool. So you can compose a sound score on it by the way you move, and then you might be able to play that sound back and then move to it, and then you might be able to make and record one of the projections with the proximity sensor, and then you've got this lovely environment that you've created through the app. You've got the live performer, you can use a projector to project the images, and you can play the sound back, and then you could mix that with the live sound. Depends how techy you want to get in your space. So, and then future development. So testing and developing the design principles with more schools. So there were 6 schools in this project. And that's quite a few. That is a range of different kinds of environments. Longitudinal studies. So we did 3 blocks of 6 weeks in our research with the different schools, which is enough for the research in a pilot project. But we didn't really measure the longitudinal impact of integrating apps into learning and into choreographic learning. And that would be interesting. You know, if you're consistently using an app to kind of develop your skills, what kind of impact does that have on your learning? And then longitudinal studies on the impact of app-based learning on the development of motor skills, well-being, self-knowledge and somatic practices. And again, this is like an emerging field as well, so the kind of app that you use will probably really affect that as well. So there's some of the kind of future questions that we were left with. So I think that's all I'm going to say. Yeah.